good afternoon. My name is Deshaun Marquis. The artist I chose was Cliff Brawa. He's a Native American artist from Pueblo Jemez tribe, which is located in New Mexico. He was born in 1955 to a family of artists. Five generations on his mother's line were potters, so he has an artistic background. He studied under legendary sculptor Alan Hauser at the Institution of American Indian Arts in Santa Fe, New Mexico, from 1973 to 75, and at a stone shop in Italy in 1987. He has a spiritual approach to sculpting, or he believes the process of sculpting is a spiritual one. When he's choosing the stone, he believes the stone has spirit, so when he's choosing the stone, he puts his ear up to the stone and taps on it to listen for a ring. And if it rings, that means the stone is solid. And he interprets that process as the stone is like singing to him. And so that's how he chooses the stone before he begins this project. His process of sculpting is just to begin, just to start carving at it. And then once he begins that, he looks at the shape of it and has a vision of what the stone wants to be. And so he kind of just ties that spirituality of the stone back into, or back into it. So, he views the process of it as removing all the parts that aren't supposed to be there, so the excess stone, to reveal the personality from within the stone. And so I just thought that was a pretty interesting view of sculpture. So a majority of his sculptures are of women, and so that's his major influence. And like many other Native American groups, the Pueblo are a matrilineal society. So that kind of just means that the clanship comes from the mother's side. The hair is kind of passed down from the mother's line. And so to honor that, most of his works are the women of his community, or a representation of it. The faces of the women on his sculptures, it comes from the energy of the stone. And so it's not specifically of any type of, or any person. It's just kind of like he communicates with the stone, like a kind of telepathy thing. And as he's chipping away at the facial parts, it's like the stone is telling him what parts to take away. So that's where the face of the stone comes from. An example of that is this sculpture right here. It's the name of it is The Potter, and it's to honor his grandmother, who was a potter. One of his, or is arguably his most popular sculpture is Pope, which is this guy right here, sculpture. Frava was awarded the commission to create a sculpture to represent the state of New Mexico in the National Statuary Hall in Washington, D.C. And so he chose to create this sculpture, which is an exception to his usual process, which is to just start carving into it. So he actually planned this one out. But today it's on display in the Emancipation Hall in the Capitol Building Visitor Center, and the only sculpture in the hall that was made by an indigenous person. Popeye, though, he was, he organized and led the revolution against the Spanish oppressors in 1680 in New Mexico. And so, then it, that was called the Pueblo Revolt. The stone used for Popeye was a 7-ton Tennessee marble. That kind of looks like this right here, this red block of marble. However, he knocked 5 tons of it off to create the 7-foot-tall sculpture. And if you could tell, it's kind of has like a red tint or a shade. He purposely chose that to kind of get this skin color right of kind of the Native Americans. So, in conclusion, basically, these elements help kind of define who he is and his significance as an artist or his career as an artist, and which were his spiritual approach to sculpting and the influences of women from his community and his major statement piece, Popeye. So, thanks for listening.